zombie, a frightening creature, which is a dead person who has been brought back to life, but without human qualities. Zombies are not able to think, and they are often shown as attacking and eating human beings.
This old-time radio program was originally aired live, long before the advent of high fidelity.
As a result,
Tori and Lenny, we'll get to the dogs in a second.
How is this wrong?
Due to transmission problems.
Oh, if I were a zombie.
If you're a zombie, monster, ghoul, or fiend.
What's in your head?
Save these houses and your soul.
May actually crawl from their graves and join us again.
Head hangs lowly. Child, we slowly take
down. Hello again, and welcome back to K-Nun Radio. As usual, I am your host,
K-Nun,
a man of many voices,
live and direct.
That's right, K-Nun Radio, bringing you the sounds from so far underground that we're on the other side of the world.
Working tirelessly around the clock to bring anti-dog sentiment into the mainstream, one broadcast at a time.
In a video I originally wrote over a year and a half ago, I remarked that the inquiry into a certain question on the entire dog phenomenon reminds me of the tale of Victor Frankenstein. After all, the monster he assembles is freakishly strong, and much more so than the strongest human, but has the brain capacity of an infant. And the man's creation ends up ruining his life. These details alone reflect the state we find ourselves in with dogs. Frankly, it is very easy to liken dogs to monsters. But their unfaltering devotees, the nutters themselves, are themselves akin to zombies, aren't they? About half a year ago, I did a video where I asked the question, is there a mind-controlling parasite from dogs afflicting dog nutters? It is a question many have pondered. While the hypothesis of a dog-originated mind-controlling brainworm that has hijacked the cognitive faculties of these lunatics has not been scientifically confirmed as of yet, it would certainly explain a lot. It would connect the dots for sure, wouldn't it, between the major disconnect dog nutters have from things like self-preservation and the most basic regard for their own communities, their own families, and their own mental and physical health.
We know that there are real-life parasites capable of mind control. Hairworms are one example, but they aren't the only ones. There is also the organism responsible for toxoplasmosis, which causes a reduction in fear of cats in rodents, and in a particular fungus, which many people know about from the video game The Last of Us. It is a protozoan, and Toxoplasma gondii infects most species of warm-blooded animals, including humans.
Ophiocordyceps unilateralis, otherwise known as cordyceps or zombie ant fungus, infects insects such as ants or spiders. Like other parasites, cordyceps drains its host completely of nutrients before filling its body with spores that will let the fungus reproduce.
Others have proposed the theory that the dog itself is a brood parasite of sorts. This is a type of parasitism where one animal fools another into rearing its young. It is commonly seen among birds, in which the parasitic bird lays its eggs in the nest of another bird. There are plenty of videos and articles on this phenomenon, which is as interesting as it is bizarre. And it's one thing when a bird tricks another, but are humans really so easy to fool? It is fairly obvious that dogs today are definitely parasites in human society. And just to make it clear for the dog nutters out there who may be watching, that's not meant as an insult. Rather, it is a strong possibility that dogs are actually brood parasites. After all, they've somehow managed to get us to take them in, provide them with all our resources, rear their young, and all the rest of it. Plenty of dog lunatics even talk like they seriously don't understand the very basic and very obvious differences between humans and dogs, like how we're two completely separate species, for starters, or the fact that we are not canines and never will be. Honestly, it is insane. Dogs do not view humans as being the same as they are. And we're often told, aren't we, that the human-dog relationship was once symbiotic. For that matter, many people will say that this continues to be the case. But looking around today, we can clearly see that what tiny benefits may be derived from the presence of dogs if there are any at all, simply pale in comparison to the enormous resources utterly wasted on dogs. Apart from some level of subjective emotional fulfillment for some dog owners on a personal level, albeit not without all the external costs to society, the only possible benefit one can maybe point to is working dogs in some very rare and niche scenarios, like sled pulling dogs in remote regions where they still do that sort of thing. However, it is always up for debate whether the dog is a necessity at all in any scenario, and whether or not we should be looking more towards technological alternatives. More importantly, even such things in no way justify the dog population explosion we are still experiencing everywhere. The fact that a few farmers may still use dogs in no way explains or justifies the current trend of dogs as household pets and so-called support animals, with a major corporate push behind it. The fact that dogs may have had some utility in the past does not justify the presence of dogs in modern cities. As one Redditor put it,
"What we're doing is we are creating a very toxic environment because we've been conditioned into believing that a dog is a necessary companion in order to be happy, which it most certainly is not. You can live life and be happy without a dog. Why is it that people think they need dogs to make themselves happy?"
And if you fool yourself, you will make him happy.
Now, I personally think people are largely being brainwashed and socially conditioned into treating dogs like human babies. We see evidence of this everywhere. Cringe terms like fur baby and dog mom are easy examples to point to. Then there is also the trend of dog nutters nowadays, referring to literally every dog as a baby, or a puppy, pup, pupper, and so on. But realistically, there's just no comparison between raising a human child to adulthood and having a dog as a pet. They're two different things, but in the parasite paradigm, we can clearly see how it benefits the parasite, which in this case is the dog, when the host organism views the offspring of its parasite as its own. Now, clearly you will never give birth to a dog, and pretending you've adopted one is not going to make the dog view you as one of its own. Moreover, this isn't even the same species as you. Even without any knowledge of taxonomy, it is just apparent to the naked eye, and to even the dumbest brute, that a dog is fundamentally a very different kind of thing compared to something like ourselves. Dogs are an environmental catastrophe and a social pollutant. They are a walking biohazard, and they have no real place in human settlements. Not to mention, their mere presence is enough to terrorize entire neighborhoods. But their unbridled proliferation, which is to say the way they are bred and allowed to propagate without any limits, is a serious threat to the future of our precious planet. We are already long past the physical problems caused by dogs, and this was noted as far back as the late 1970s. Dogs are one of very few species with no natural checks on their numbers. This lunacy is simply not sustainable. Unfortunately, it is up to us to convince those capable of understanding reality. Facts and lived experiences cannot be dismissed by a cult-like obsession over a foreign parasite, a scrounger, a moocher, a leech, an opportunist. Clearly, the minds of dog fanatics everywhere have been hijacked, and in terms of engagement, it is evident that they are severely compromised on this issue. But before closing out, I leave you nutters with a bit of food for thought all the same, pulled again from a Reddit post, in the mad hope that something will finally sink in, even for just one of you.
If there is something you cannot live without, you should think very carefully about if you should have it at all. Because that need may lead you to make dangerous and irresponsible choices that could do more harm to your life, or others, than going without that thing.
So